Can you believe it? Here we are again. I mean, have we been doing this for 10 years?
I think so, yeah.
That was like at least 50 pounds ago.
Raise your hand if you were at that first show in 2005, or clap, I can't see you.
Yeah, well, you know, G. Morris, I was thinking, what keeps us doing?
Well, I don't know. Maybe that calls for a classic bit. A top 10 list.
Yeah, top 10 reasons we keep doing this.
Here we go.
Number 10. Royce Hall crew has some really great dope. Yeah, but it's all medicinal, man.
Number 9. Comedy doesn't fit into workshop format.
Don't really have anything else to do at work.
Number 7, rejected at first stage auditions of X Factor.
Number 6, love doing top 10 lists.
Number 5, invited platform presentation still looks good on CV.
Four, organizing committee too nice to say enough already.
Still waiting for invitation to The Daily Show.
GSA concerned, meeting attendance will plummet without it. And the number one reason.
The pay is so good.
All right. So, this seems to be the theme here. You know, in the spirit of the historical retrospective, we thought we should explain how this got started.
So the show really began shortly after the Big Bang, when quarks coalesced into the first atoms of matter that eventually became part of the Worm Show. Too far back?
Okay. Fast forward to 2004, when the actual first show took place at the West Coast Worm Meeting at UC Santa Barbara. Okay. So, you see, here's what happened. So a short time earlier, Morris and I had talked about how the worm meetings were getting really big and they were too serious, too stuffy, boring. Okay.
So we put together some ideas in a PowerPoint presentation and we did a half hour show to an audience of about 200 people. Now, who was at that one? Hey, great.
Yeah. So at the end of the first show, someone encouraged us to present it at the next international meeting.
So we put a plan into place. I sent the 2005 meeting organizers, who were Monica Driscoll and Tim Shadle, who are here tonight, I sent them each a disc with a video
disc,
of the show.
You remember what those are, right?
Physical media, yeah.
We couldn't stream it on Netflix. So, you know, as Monica told us later, so she started watching the video on her TV, but she had a guest, and they ended up going into the kitchen and spending the whole time there, and so the show played to an empty room. She never saw it.
So when she and Tim had to make a decision, they got in touch by phone. So we imagine the conversation went something like this.
So this comedy show, what do you think?
Seems ooky. I guess we say yes.
Okay, so but then when they met up at the meeting, the actual meeting itself, Monica had a confession to make.
I never watched the thing.
And Tim said,
neither did I.
So, it turns out they had no idea what they had approved. Okay? So why
do you think the show has endured all these years?
Well, obviously, it's got to be our team of writers.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. Yeah. Well, so what should we do?
Well, in the spirit of this, you know, retrospective, we're going to give you some highlights of our favorite Worm Show moments.
And hopefully some of yours.
If your family doesn't know what you do for a living, you might be a scientist. If you own an old Toyota and a new Mac, you might be a scientist.
Requires a quantity for movement. Yes.
So these ones are move well, they cannot.
Come on, Andy. Oh, come on.
Despite overwhelming evidence supporting the hypothesis, the Bush two worms won. And in fact, you can see that the blue ones got all pushed all over here to the west side. The west side of the plate. Here over here.
Staying alive. Staying alive. using pipettes to teach development?
Female that makes its own sperm.
What? You put pictures of people, yes, doing such a time, yes?
No, not that.
I like work in your lab.
I don't think that I can commit to that.
Is the anti-war. AKA the dominant negative.
I like jumping oaks and I cannot lie. You other women can't deny. But when a worm crawls out with the oversized goods and a wild type on your plate, you get stuck. Wanna see my kid?
Segment is brought to you by
UGG Tryptophan Boots.
Unexpected appearance of Sydney Brenner in Southern Belong.
A always B B C cloning. Always be cloning. Always be cloning.
D C C G A T.
Hola, soy Donna. Today we're going to clone a gene.
So in my lab, we're interested in why worms are different than mice.
Try one didn't work so good, so we're on try two now.
Can I ask you a question about worm base? You gonna make this thing faster? Cause like sometimes they wait like a half an hour.
This worm is your worm. This worm is my worm. From Cambridge, England, to Tokyo, Japan.
Make your abstract really abstract.
Yes.
Oh yeah, that piece, yeah, that's my favorite, yeah.
What's your favorite phenotype? Curtis.
Worm show.
Oh.
Put as many plates as possible in the UV link.
Armchair biologist, armchair biologist. Not a slave to the benchtop anymore.
How's your morning?
Oh, mate, flat out like a lizard drinking, you?
Yeah, bonds up. Not sure Annika's is going well, though. She came in mad as a cut snake earlier, going off like a bucket of prawns in the sun.
Fair dinkum.
Nicotine alters microRNAs.
Chromatin silencing persistence.
MRP5 transports heme.
Sexy.
And we never get sleep, sleep, sleep.
I'm gonna pop some mats and pick up 20 babies of my classmates. I'm hunting, looking for Transformers. This is freaking awesome. Yeah.
Curtis, what's been in the news since the last worm meeting?
Well, you know, for starters, we're lucky that we weren't at this meeting last year. There was a big flood at UCLA because of a nearby broken water main. The whole floor of Folly Pavilion, which had just been renovated, had to be redone.
Do you suppose one of the local worm labs left their pipette washer on again?
No, I think they were testing a giant people sorter. You know, all this water gives me an idea. Maybe the next worm meeting could be on a cruise ship. GSA, what do you say?
Yeah? The worm boat.
Okay.
Hey, Curtis, did you notice that the abstracts were due on April 16th?
Yeah, that was really great. Good call on that. Those of you who don't know, you know, the international group, that's the day that taxes are due in the U.S., right?
Well, you can guess what happened. I accidentally sent my tax return to the worm meeting and my abstracts to the U.S. government.
So what happened then?
Well, I'm getting audited. The IRS says I claimed thousands of worms as dependents.
And so what did the GSA do with your tax returns? Did they publish them in G3?
No, the GSA thought that it was part of the comedy show.
Oh, that's because how much money you make?
Oh, no, I think it's because they couldn't believe I have a job. In other news, Scotland voted to stay with the United Kingdom last year.
Really? No kidding. Are there any worm labs in Scotland?
Yes, there's Dr. Mark Blackstone of the University of Edinburgh.
Doctor who?
Yeah, he's Scottish too!
You know, we also found out that NBC anchor Brian Williams started the Sea Elegance Field. At least that's how he remembers it.
Yes, and of course we know now that labs all around the world are now posting signs that look like this.
In other news, self-fertilization is now legal in Ireland by popular vote. And this just in.
The Supreme Court of the United States just legalized self-fertilization too!
Oh my God, Morris, I just realized we're supposed to start the show.
Oh, that's right.
Let me run the official start title here.
Science, the final frontier. These are the voyages of the species C. elegans. Its ongoing mission, to explore strange new phenotypes, to seek out new methods and new innovations, to boldly clone what no one has cloned before.
I thought I was going to get to play Spock.
Well, just because many of us are sci-fi fanatics, of course we're wearing these in honor of the late Leonard Nimoy.
Just had to, right? Had to. Okay. So, you know, I heard that in Canada, they're putting Spock in the $5 bill.
You know, I think they ought to put Sidney Brenner on there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, there we go. Okay. Well, we've got to officially welcome you to the 2015 Worm Show. Okay, yeah, finally get started. And our first segment is brought to you by...
Xcal for C. elegans. Now $2 with free shipping.
And the very gradual change that we can believe in, T-shirt.
So we'd like to present the first of two parts of contributions to what we're calling the Worm Show Gazette. Okay, so these are from the community, one page, and
we take anything. Uncensored.
Uncensored. So here we go.
Yeah.
This is real. Dutch king and queen visit the worm lab. Yeah.
I think they asked him, can you please pick us some rollers, your highness?
Okay, some groaners. What kind of classical music do scientists listen to in lab?
Centrifuges?
Mm-hmm. They are groaners. Well, empirically, they are groaners. Yeah. What does C. elegans do before exercise?
A warm-up.
Yeah. What do nematodes wear on Halloween?
Ascaricides.
Yeah, okay.
And then here's one.
Hey, everybody, look. Dear Abby.
Oh. Hmm. year, Abby. Botox mutants look younger. A lot younger.
Funny student homework.
That's real.
Spanx for dumpy worms.
Produces small eggle phenocopy.
Small eggle phenocopy, yeah. Exactly. Gotta cut a hole in there or something.
Yeah. Spinal Tap water bath. This goes to 11.
Goes to 11.
Back in my day, we made our own restriction enzymes.
My plasmid preps overgrew. Now I've lost a day.
I don't always do PCR, but when I do, I use the most expensive tack I can.
And our next segment is brought to you by the Worm Compass. Oh, just discovered that.
And Golden Gate Tailing Kits, now $5 with free shipping.
And here's our video of you guys at registration, Worm Community.
So what's the best thing about working in the C. elegans field?
Fluorescent worms. It's the best thing ever. It's all there is. I just like to watch them. I just want to watch. I never want to stop watching, ever.
I mean, it's easy to handle, yes.
Short lifespan, so life cycle.
Great genetic tool.
Easily manipulatable.
Ooh, the best thing about working with C. elegans is they provide a great model system for studying mitochondrial mutations, which is what we study.
All the different phenotypes like rollers and unks, and the fact that they're so visible and beautiful that you can see through them.
I work on Brixie.
You can make a mistake and 3 days later, you're just back doing the same thing over again with a little difference. It's so fast.
You can thaw them and they live. I have graduate students that are younger than some of the worms that are in my lab right now.
Getting to play with GFP.
I used to work on parasites and I spent all my time generating enough material to do an experiment. So it's a really tractable system to grow up. So that's really cool.
Yep. Put C. elegans on DR, which is dietary restriction.
Yes.
You can feel much fitter.
The people, probably. The people and the rollers.
They make great baits.
They make great what?
Bait, one bait.
No one ever tries to figure out what you're doing. You tell them and they don't care anymore.
You don't have to work with that many males.
Do you mean the people or the animals?
Doesn't matter.
The people, that's it. It's the people.
Tim already said it, the people.
There's manageably small size and there's a spirit of community.
Definitely community, community.
The international meeting.
Well, I just think the community is really welcoming and there's so much information out there to study and so there's work for everybody.
So I think the best part is how it is so welcoming to undergraduate researchers.
What is the best thing about working in the C. elegans field?
The people.
The brilliance of the people, the sense of humor, the community, the organism. It's an amazing place of complete discovery every day.
Oh, goodness. Okay, well, my dear worm community, it has happened again. Curtis and I have another confession.
We gave a show to another community.
Okay, we think this was actually okay because the community includes the worm community.
Yeah, it's like a multi-sum or something. Right. So, okay, so here are some highlights of that meeting, SDB meeting, including a tribute to model organisms all around. What do you think about C. elegans?
Oh, they like to wander around a lot.
They're okay. Those are the worms, right?
You know, there are no coat colors in worms. Who could work on a worm with no coat colors?
They don't have limbs. I study limb patterning, so having legs and wings is a really good thing. Sorry.
Worms are fantastic, I think. You know what? They're almost as good as flies.
You could say, no, they're great. I love that short generation time. The fact you can freeze them down. I mean, that's a cool thing. Freezing them down.
My colleague, Paul Sternberg, is a very dear friend, so I think very highly of them. And I think the genetics is great. And I'm totally jealous. No, I'm just totally jealous.
They're very beautiful when you look at them under the microscope.
I like C. elegans. It's not warm and fuzzy, but you can cuddle up to it intellectually.
Oh, I love C. elegans. It's one of my favorite systems when I'm teaching. One of the big rewards I always get is at the end of the semester, I actually ask students what their favorite section of the course was, and I always love it that there's people in the class who most love my C. elegans lectures.
Awesomest model system ever.
C. elegans, it's a little too small. The embryos, the first time I saw them, I thought they were dust.
What do you think of C. elegans?
What's that? That's the first time I ever heard of it.
It's a great organism. It's very smooth.
Defined lineage. Did I get that right?
So, Marty, what's this thing with M. cherry? They did not invite us back. We've come crawling back to the C. elegans community.
Or was it swimming?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, so Morris, what really keeps you coming to UCLA?
Oh man, it's the food. Yeah. Where else can you eat ad libitum like this? I mean, this morning I had a Krispy Kreme donut double cheeseburger.
Yeah, oh. I mean, wow, I heard that you can get those in the cardiac cafe section.
And I noticed two more innovations this year.
Oh yeah, you know, I love the lockers that they have next to the dining room. I mean, those are awesome.
Well, I was thinking how much good stuff I could get by punching in 4 zeros, you know, on all of them, or 1, 2, 3, 4.
And you know what, even better? The double name tag.
Yeah, ooh, come on.
Flip it over. You know, it only took them like, what, 40 years to figure this out?
This is awesome.
Okay, yeah.
I thought my memory was getting better because I was remembering people's names, and it's only because 100% of the tags are up now.
Yeah.
Instead of 50%.
Oh, 50? You think it's 50? No.
No, it was before.
Anyway, but you know, there are, of course, some things that all of us don't like about meetings, right?
Okay. So the number 10.
Poster tube mistaken by TSA for rocket launcher.
You forgot someone's name and their tag is backwards. Well, that doesn't...
Oh, wait a minute. That doesn't count anymore. Dorm shower control. 1 millimeter between ice and inferno.
People who didn't get a talk leaving the poster blank out of anger.
Oh, in your talk, having to refer people to a poster that happened yesterday.
Number 5, two great talks happening at the same time.
Crossing the threshold where one half of the people, or 75%, or 95% of the people are younger than you are.
Sessions that start only 2 hours after you got to sleep.
Roommate unexpectedly observes open door urination policy. And the number one reason, workshops
occur during regular nap time.
Now we have a couple video contributions, one from the Kim Lab, one from the Walto Lab.
Thank you.
To Simon and Garfunkel. That's what we're going to do.
All right. I'd like to thank Dave Reiner for making some contributions here. Okay.
A winter's day in a cool and dark incubator. I am a mutant, eating my E. coli, moving very slow on a richly seeded lawn, so I will grow. I am a mech. I am a roller. I have my gut and my cuticle to protect me. I am shielded by collagen. Now here comes a needle opening in my nads, filling me, and now my kids will glow. I am a mech. I am a roller. Feels no pain, and a roller always tries. Chris Bell, you're breaking my heart, you're shaking my confidence daily. Whoa, Chris Bell, I'm down on my knees, I'm begging you please to knock out, making strains in the afternoon. CRISPR in the injection room. I get up to get some plates. When I come back to lab, someone's taking my place. CRISPR, you're breaking my heart, you're shaking my confidence daily. Oh, CRISPR, I'm down on my knees, I'm begging you please to knock out, to knock out. Ba 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 ba. I fall on the floor and I'm laughing. Transformation and NHEJ. My project goes on, I'll get funding. Whisper, you're breaking my heart, you're shaking my confidence daily. Oh, Whisper, I'm down on my knees, I'm begging you please to knock in, to knock in.
And now we have a contribution from Marina Kanzeva. From the Hand Lab. And a couple other things for you.
Yeah. Yeah. Cleanse the palate.
Are you tired of having to leave lab to get a snack or drink your coffee? Now your problems are all over. With the plain sight storage containers, you can have your cake in the lab and eat it too. Our product line features several easy-to-hide storage containers that blend in with your laboratory equipment and consumables. So next time you're hungry or thirsty in lab, reach for your food and drink in plain sight. In plain sight labware, let me get on with my work.
Where's that fitting waste?
Give me a G. Give me another G. One more. What does that make?
That makes G3.
G3.
artificial sweeteners, artificial sweeteners, artificial sweeteners will kill you.
And make you fat.
And make you fat. Elegance, worm atlas. In the worm lab, the peaceful worm lab, the tower sleeps tonight.
What's the best thing about working in the C. elegans field?
I just like the fact that it's this thing that can, you know, make 300 copies of itself in 3 days, right? It's like, it blows your mind. I think it's fun. Of course, the people are fun too. So people, anyone get excited about a worm? I mean, they gotta be kind of a nice person, right? So that's what's fun about it.
You think we can get out this way?
So lately it's become apparent that many journals are trying to adapt to the way we get information in a modern context.
Yeah, so for example, you know, many journals ask authors to supply highlights or even make a video of their presentation of their work.
So we've identified three ways that the journals haven't yet tried that could be used to bring attention to our research. These are listicles, charticles, and clickbait.
So what's a listicle?
Well, here's an example of a listicle.
5 things we hate about CRISPR-Cas.
Yeah.
Okay, well, so then what's a charticle?
Charticle? Okay. Well, that's a diagram with just the important information, almost like a brief poster, like this one.
Okay. All right, so we've got a listicle and a charticle. So if there was a short quiz after the charticle, it would be a...
A testicle. Moving on to clickbait, we're going to give you 3 examples using classical papers in the worm field.
Okay, so. Brenner's original 1973 paper, The Genetics of Caenorhabditis elegans.
In clickbait form, I mutagenized worms, the results will shock you!
Okay. Ellison Horvitz, 1986, Genetic Control of Programmed Cell Death.
Clickbait version, there are genes that can kill you. The reasons why will make you angry.
And finally, Fire and Mellows, 1998 paper, Potent and Specific Genetic Interference by Double-Stranded RNA in C. elegans.
Clickbait version, we injected double-stranded RNA, you won't believe what happened next.
Presenting a music collection like no other. Now that's what I call worms. Featuring Megan Trainor.
Because you know I'm all about worm bass, about worm bass, no food ladder. I'm all about worm bass, about worm bass, no food ladder. I'm all about worm bass, about worm bass, no food ladder. I'm all about worm bass, about worm bass. Hey!
Nate Bruce.
I am nothing without worms. I'm but a dude stuck in.
Perry. Maroon 5.
Lucas, yes, please. What you want to do for me? Like I was saying, Chris, I go. Like I'm transformed, like someone take me.
And Taylor Swift. Now that's what I call Worms, in stores now.
They thought they had discovered a scientific nirvana, where everything was still possible. Publications were assured. Tenure was easy. They made it possible to create a hybrid nematode using DNA from long extinct dinosaurs, creating a dinosaur worm with an extremely simple and accessible nervous system. But what they didn't realize was that the behavior that they would be studying would be hunting, and it would be hunting them.
Our next segment is brought to you by Postdoc Brewing. This is real, actually. You know,
make your postdocs with yeast and hops.
And Linux. Linux is free if your time is worthless. Okay, next.
They publish in Nature, Science, and Cell, but can they teach? Let's see how our favorite worm PIs measure up in the classroom.
Wait. Shouldn't this really be called?
Like, hate my professors.
Yeah.
Okay, our first one is, okay, we're just kidding.
We wouldn't really.
Oh, no, so people were squirming.
Yeah, you were worried.
Yeah,
so was
right.
I.
We wouldn't do that. Shame on you for thinking that we would.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, so what do we have now? The second part of the Worm Show Gazette.
Yeah,
right?
Worm Show Gazette. Worm Show Gazette number 2.
Okay. Star Trek wireless keyboard. Okay. Yeah, see, someone's explaining it to their neighbors. That's great. That's great.
Preparation H, relief from the pain of plasmid mini preps.
Magic worm blower, make up your own joke here.
This is for real. Also for real.
You can buy this.
CRISPR
is the new moss. HBO show, apparently.
And now, someplace to put those CRISPRized strains. You know, assuming you actually get some.
If worms use Tinder to hook up, we got Sid there, wild and young, will settle for self.
Some like it short, I am fun size.
That's some nice advice for you.
Yeah, good.
Evolution of the American Professor.
Sort of a sad one.
Very sad.
Yeah.
Okay, it is a sad one. I'm really sorry about that. New plasmids from odd gene.
Odd gene.
I mean, that's, those really are odd, right?
No.
Gene names that suggest something else.
Yeah, okay.
paired end reed instruments.
No, okay. Okay. And finally, I accidentally used Caspase 9 and it doesn't work for genome editing.
Oh, are you sure Cas9 does? No.
And now a contributed video from Joanne Angerbrecht at UC Davis, whose students made a video about maternal effect lethal screen.
Cece, what are you drawing?
Oh.
Well, what's that inside of her?
Baby worms.
Baby worms?
Mm-hmm.
Have you heard the story of Celigans?
No.
Do you want to hear it?
Yes.
Do you want to hear it?
There once was a worm named Celigans. And she was a very happy little worm, content in her little worm world. Until one day at worm school, a classmate of Cella's began to tease her. "You don't have a vulva," teased little Miss Clementine. "Your children would eat their way out of you." Until now, Cella hadn't noticed that. But looking in the mirror, she found that her kid was absolutely right. Cella had no vulva. Of course, Cella Gans became quite worried about this part. Was it true that her children were peeking out of her? Would they gnaw and bite until they burst from her skin? Her dreams at night were filled with these The next day, she resolved to set off and find a wizard rumored to live under the gray microscope. She left her hometown of Dirk, squirmed across the barren benchtop, and snapped at the auger fields. She finally reached microscope and found the wizard sitting in a bright light. When he heard her question, the wizard frowned. He examined Cella, gazed around her, mumbled unintelligibly. Finally, the wizard smiled and spoke to Cella.
"I can see into your genome. You'll be fine, child. Look, you see here, these are the two recessive alleles that cause you to have a vulva. Now, under normal circumstances, you would need to be worried. But these two recessive alleles mean that your children will die. So, you needn't worry about them eating you from the inside."
Greatly relieved to learn this, Cella became curious about how the wizard could know such things. And so she stayed with the wizard and learned a great many things.
The end.
Did you like the story?
Yeah. Aw, poor Cella. Little does she know, she's been engineered for both mutations for a researcher at UC Davis interested in studying maternal effect lethal mutations. Tomorrow, she'll be dissected so that her babies can be removed for further study. Aw.
Is Joanne here? Is Joanne here? You are, yeah. So those are undergraduate students? Well, that is terrific.
Excellent.
Undergraduates made that. Okay, our next segment is brought to you by 1KB Ladder Plus, 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 plus. The next version is just gonna be a smear, I think.
Yes, and worm base for the Apple Watch. Now your Apple can have worms.
It doesn't quite fit. Fit on that screen. There's going to be a lot of...
You know, there's going to be a lot of pinching and zooming.
Pinching and zooming.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, you know, many of you may be out on the job market very soon, so we'd like to give you some advice, okay? Things you need to think about.
Jobs are scarce. Cast a wide net.
Okay, chalk talk does not mean talking about chalk.
Do not wear unconventional outfits.
Do not mention the worm show. It will not help.
For an administrative position, a vision seminar should not involve the following image.
But you could put some subliminal text at the bottom if you had to.
Don't badmouth other model systems.
No. Avoid use of emojis in your talk.
Don't drink too much at dinner.
And finally, check your cover letter very carefully.
All right, we're almost done.
Thank God.
Before our final segment, we'd like to thank these folks, the organizers,
yep.
Jillian and Ben.
Yep. Anne-Marie and the GSA, thank you.
The Royce Hall crew here.
Come on.
Those of you that sent us videos and pictures and images,
thank you
very much. For the funny ones, anyway.
And, of course, all of you.
All of you, the worm community.
Yeah, thank you.
Especially those of you that are really good sports.
Okay. Yes.
All right, so our last video is from my lab, and it asks the question, what if the worm field never got started?
Yeah, what if Sydney never started the worm field?
Life on sabbatical. They said, go somewhere, do something really cool. Nah, I said, I'm staying right here. Got a lab, did some experiments, wrote up some papers, cleaned up the office a little bit, bought some neat stuff on Amazon.com, Rubik's Cube mug, Cell Cycle coasters, floating TARDIS. Yeah, life's pretty good. I should have gone somewhere.
Morris spent a few weeks reconfiguring his office. I'm not sure if it's increased his productivity, though. He mostly hangs around in there with a new faculty member, Adler. They've been in his office all day. I don't even want to know what they've been up to.
What do you got? That beats a straight flush!
10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20.
A vowel! Vowel, you know this! Come on! I got you, babe. I'm Adler Dillman. I'm the newest faculty member in the Department of Nematology here at UC Riverside, and I work with host-parasite interactions. I mainly study Studonema carpocapsi, but I have this really cool insect that I think you'll want to check out, mole crickets. They're awesome.
According to the Hitchhiker's Guide to Arthropods, mole crickets are the family Gryllotalpidae. Through an astonishing coincidence, mole crickets are food for both nematodes and humans alike. When humans and nematodes eventually leave the Earth to colonize other planets, they will be heard to say, so long and thanks for all the mole crickets. This is the last time mole crickets will be mentioned in our story.
I'm meeting an undergraduate later today to talk about doing research in the lab. It's really tough to know if undergraduates are suited to working in a model system. It's also difficult to know what their real motives are. But I've come up with a new test that I think is going to allow me to finally get the answers to those tough questions.
So that's pretty much what we work on. What do you think?
So, you trying to cure disease or something?
Do you have a couple minutes?
Reaction time is a factor in this, so please pay attention. All animals are eukaryotes. Plants are eukaryotes. Therefore, all plants are animals. True or false?
False.
What is a gene?
A segment of DNA along a chromosome.
Are you going to ask me for a letter of recommendation?
Maybe.
Are you a pothead?
Huh?
No, you're a smoke pot.
But is this part of the test?
You're in a desert, and all of a sudden you look down and see a tortoise. You reach down and flip it over on its back. The tortoise lays on its back trying to turn itself over, but it can't. Not without your help. Why aren't you helping, Colin?
I don't know. I don't like tortoises.
He passed the test. And, got a second?
What's that you got there, Morris?
This is a picture of me at my first fly meeting, 1993.
Oh, you look so young.
Can we talk for a minute? All week I've had this feeling that something's just not right.
Really? Me too. Like everything's out of whack.
You know, I'm not sure if I'm supposed to be working on fruit flies.
Well, why are you working on flies?
Well, I guess it all started with Sydney Brenner. It says here that Brenner started working with Drosophila because of something that he read in the 1950s that made him want to use it as a model to study the nervous system.
That doesn't sound right.
Doesn't sound right to me either. I thought in the 60s Brenner chose to work with something different. What do you think's going on?
I have a hypothesis. Something didn't happen here in 1955, it was supposed to happen, and that's why Brenner ended up working with flies.
So what should we do?
Well, we have to get a message to him to convince him to work on something else.
Something else like what?
Well, how about a nematode? There's this non-parasitic species that nobody works on, but it might be interesting. Cenobitis elegans?
So what we need to do is we need to get a letter to Sidney Brenner to convince him to work on worms.
Dear Dr. Brenner, you should tame a small metazoan. Consider working with a nondescript nematode conveniently found in your home garden, Cenobitis elegans. Sincerely, Anonymous. The big question is, how are we supposed to get this thing back to 1955?
I think I have a way that we can solve that problem.
So are you telling me you built a time machine out of a Subaru?
Well, I figured if you're going to make a time machine, why not make it out of the car you already own?
So should we get in?
Yeah.
Time circuits ready?
Check. Got the letter?
Check.
Let's go.
All right.
Citrus Experiment Station.
What am I supposed to do?
Well, take that letter and just pop it into a mailbox.
And you should be looking at your picture to see if it works. Well, I did it.
It worked, dude.
Yes. Let's go back to the future.
Everything's back to normal. These worms look a bit contaminated, though.
Hey, Ailey.
Hey, how are you?
All right. You look upset.
It's just been a long day in lab. How was your day?
It's okay. I was with some of my freshman mentees, and they had just finished their introductory molecular biology final. And
fun.
They got upset over a question about the two strands of DNA, and they told me that they just couldn't quite understand how to differentiate between the Adler and the Dillman strand, but, you know, tests go, that's not that many points, so I'm sure they did fine, they're just overreacting.
What did you just say?
Like, you know, the Adler strand and the Dillman strand, the two strand of DNA? Like, don't you teach us in your class?
Did you learn all this stuff when you were in university?
Adler!
Got a question for you, Biff.
Shoot.
Did you know that the two strands of DNA are called the Adler strand and the Dillman strand?
Funny coincidence, that.
It's in all the textbooks.
Wasn't it always like that?
Did you borrow my time machine?
No.
Do you have a second?
Okay.
You're watching a stage play. A banquet is in progress. The guests are enjoying an appetizer of raw oysters. The entree consists of boiled dog.
Mmm, dog.
Thank you all.